The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3984 in the name of Adam Tomkins on Community Jobs Scotland. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Adam Tomkins to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Tomkins.
Deputy Presiding Officer, this is an apt week to be debating an aspect of policy relating to jobs, employment and skills. For this, of course, is Scottish Apprenticeship Week. On Monday, as many MSPs across the Chamber have done during the course of this week, I visited a local employer not far from where I live in Glasgow and met with a number of apprentices who started their careers there with help from Skills Development Scotland. For employers such as the one I visited, the Little Me Nursery in Annieslan, apprenticeships are an invaluable source of recruitment, and the hands-on skills and career development that an apprenticeship offers is an ideal way for many young people to manage the transition from school to work. In that context, I'm delighted to bring to the Chamber this afternoon my motion not merely recognising but celebrating the continued success of the Community Jobs Scotland Employability Programme run by the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations. And I'd like to thank members from right across the political spectrum who have supported today's motion and all those who will take part in this afternoon's debate. None of this would have happened without the SCVO, and I'm delighted that Craig Wilson and others from SCVO are in the public gallery, or on their way to being in the public gallery, I hope, this afternoon. And they've brought with them several young men and women who have benefited from and taken part in Community Jobs Scotland, with organisations such as Move On, North Edinburgh Arts, the Bethany Christian Trust, Leap Sports Scotland and LAMH. We will gather, or we will hope to gather, at the foot of the Garden Lobby steps after this debate, and I'd like to invite all members here from across the Chamber to join me in meeting these young men and women. I understand that photo opportunities will be available. Presiding Officer, Community Jobs Scotland is an employability programme designed and delivered by SCVO. It was started in 2011 when levels of youth unemployment were much higher than they are now. It has seen job creation by third sector organisations across all 32 of Scotland's local authority areas, and it has now helped some 7,500 young men and women right across the country. Supported, I'm pleased to say, by the Scottish Government, its latest phase is targeted at young people who are furthest removed from the labour market, including carers, people with disabilities, young people leaving the armed forces, and young offenders. It's a competitive process requiring a full application and regular interview. Every CJS position benefits not only the individual, but also the community. CJS has allowed overstretched charities to build capacity and to provide improved services, whilst offering disadvantaged young people the chance to gain skills, experience, confidence, and, of course, a wage, at least the minimum wage and, where possible, the living wage. In addition, every CJS employee has access to a £200 flexible training fund. CJS has an impressive track record of success. The most recent data show that just under half of the young people using CJS moved into employment, and that 61% of people using CJS had positive outcomes in terms of growth, in terms of jobs, volunteering, or further education. And given that the programme is focused on people who are hardest to reach, people that some other employability programmes do not reach at all, these are impressive numbers. But behind the numbers, Presiding Officer, are real human beings. So let me share with you two stories from my own city, Glasgow, that illustrate the great work that Community Jobs Scotland undertakes. In Govan, just across the river from where I live, a gang of seven young men with a history of offending ran amok, terrorising the community. All the familiar ingredients were there: drugs, violence, vandalism, antisocial behaviour. The housing association stepped in, as local housing associations so often do. And after a period of working with the members of the gang, the chief executive of Govan Housing Association approached CJS to establish paid jobs for the young men. And as a result, they've now learnt skills in landscaping, paving and brickwork. Housing stock has been repaired and is maintained. And then there is the story of Ryan Brown, the 7,500th person to be helped by Community Jobs Scotland. Ryan, I think, is here today. Born in the mid-1990s, he grew up amid family breakdown, the tragedy of a baby brother's cot death, drug and alcohol addiction and domestic abuse. He was taken into care, but he developed alcohol and alcohol dependency and gang violence problems of his own. He was convicted and he spent some time in prison. He suffered a number of family bereavements, but he was helped by CJS, working with Move On's Housing Education Service, where he is responsible. for working alongside volunteers in education, providing advice and information on housing, life skills, employability, and homelessness. And I'm told that Ryan has now secured his first ever tenancy and is in a stable relationship. Thanks to CJS, he has a bright future ahead of him. These stories, and so many more like them, underscore two truths that Conservatives have prioritised in developing policy. First, that for those who can, work represents the best route out of poverty. The best route out of poverty, but also the best route out of the chaotic lifestyle of drug and alcohol addiction, violence, and antisocial behaviour. That's why it's so important that there are more jobs in the British economy than ever before, more women in employment in Britain than ever before, and record numbers of disabled people in work in Britain today. And the second truth is this, that unless we address the underlying problems of addiction, family breakdown, disorder, and yes, educational underattainment, we will never break the cycle of multiple deprivation. Robustly confronting and beating these problems requires much more than warm words, Presiding Officer. It requires bold action, early intervention, transformational investment, and of course, very close working between government, the private sector, and voluntary organisations such as the SCVO. Across this chamber, every single member of the Scottish Parliament is concerned about tackling poverty and deprivation and getting people away from crime and into work. We have our differences, of course, in terms of priorities, and I have my list of complaints about the SNP's record, as I know the Minister and his backbenchers will have their list of complaints about the Conservatives. But I brought this debate to the Parliament this afternoon in the hope that this is not the occasion for a rehearsal of such party political arguments and may instead be a moment where we can come together, united in our admiration for the work of the SCVO and in our celebration of the continued and ongoing success of Community Jobs Scotland. Thank you very much.
We move to the open debate. We're a wee bit pushed for time, so could I ask everyone to be disciplined to the 4 minutes maximum. And I call Kenny Gibson to be followed by Dean Lockhart.
Presiding Officer, first of all, I'd like to thank Adam Tomkins for lodging this motion and securing today's debate on the development of such an important programme, and the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, Craig Wilson, for his comprehensive briefing. There is much to celebrate regarding the success of the Community Jobs Scotland Employability Programme in National Apprenticeship Week, aimed at helping unemployed and vulnerable young people aged 16 to 29 into paid job training opportunities. This programme has recently reached a milestone of its 7,500th created job. First established in 2011 in response to high levels of youth unemployment, the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations run programme created 1,861 paid jobs for young people in its first year alone. By 2016, this number had risen to 7,049 paid jobs. Indeed, success rates are unmistakable, with a reported 52% of these participants being retained by their employer after the end of their initial job, and a further 62% achieving positive outcomes into jobs, volunteering or education. Through its competitive application and interview process, Community Jobs Scotland prides itself in laying the groundwork for the sense of belonging and teamwork conducive to young people's successful integration into a real work environment. Funding of £6.1 million for Phase 6 of the programme, which is currently underway, was announced by the First Minister on 16th of February 2016. This extension of the already successful initiative aimed to support a further 700 job opportunities for vulnerable young people through a range of third sector organisations across all 32 local authorities. In North Ayrshire, more than half of which consists of my own Cunningham North constituency, 330 jobs have been created and these young people work for 38 different employers. By including opportunities specifically focused on the developing the young workforce, Scotland's Youth Unemployment Strategy recommendations to support young people who are deemed hardest to reach, the programme now contributes to efforts initiated by the Commission for Developing Scotland's Young Workforce to create a world-class vocational education system capable of reducing youth unemployment by 40% by 2021. These opportunities include those aimed at the care experienced, young people with criminal convictions, early service leavers such as armed forces, and carers with 100 ring-fence places for those with a disability or long-term health condition, and a further 100 for young people progressing from a pilot of pre-CAGS work experience opportunities and continuation of the living wage. While the figures I mentioned outline the overall success of the programme, it's also rewarding to look at the personal accounts of those it's directly benefited. And one commendable such individual who we've heard much about already is Ryan Brown from Glasgow. And Adam Tomkins talked a lot about Ryan's background. Ryan made the impressive 7,500th job created and is taking on the role of trainee development worker with Move On for an initial period of 1 year. The 20-year-old was recently invited to Holyrood and commemorated as the 7,500th CGS employee. He remarked after making his decision to choose a new lifestyle that this programme has allowed him to put the past behind him, and he's now confident that a really bright future lies ahead. The programme has assisted him not only in the realm of work, but also in terms of personal relationships and domestic life, and he's now in a stable relationship and has recently secured his first tenancy. In many cases, a permanent job creates a sense of security in the lives of young people that may have previously been absent, and Ryan is but one of the thousands of success stories produced by this remarkable programme, and it's certain he will not be the last. To quote a remark made by SCVO Chief Executive Martin Syme in 2012, investing in young people through the third sector works. It works for the young people that go on to find sustainable full-time jobs, and for the sector whose capacity to deliver is being stretched like never before. Now 6 years since the programme's inception, I'm sure you will agree that these words, much like the project itself, have stood the test of time. Of course, as we celebrate this milestone, we acknowledge that there's always more to be done, more people to be helped. It's therefore vital that we maintain the support CGS offers to reach out to vulnerable young people across Scotland who have perhaps been overlooked in the past, but who wish to play an active and recognised part in Scottish society, as they deserve to do. Presiding Officer, I look forward to welcoming the continued success the future phases of Community Jobs Scotland Employability Programme will undoubtedly bring, thereby granting a bright professional future to as many hard-to-reach Scottish young people as possible.
I call Dean Lockhart to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me first congratulate my friend and colleague Adam Tomkins for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and for highlighting the many achievements of the Community Jobs Scotland programme. I would also like to commend everyone involved with the programme, including the SCVO, for their hard work, which has made it a success and which has had a very positive impact on the lives of the many young people across Scotland. I also welcome those in the public gallery who have benefited from this programme and indeed who have helped make it a success. Since its inception in 2011, the programme has created jobs in all 32 local authorities in Scotland, including in my own region, Stirling. In the Stirling area, the programme has created almost 150 jobs, ranging from jobs in sectors as diverse as conservation, hospitality, and the Scottish Gymnastics Association. In particular, the programme has reached into disadvantaged areas in Stirling through collaboration with bodies such as Rapalough Community Enterprise in the Stirling area. Rapalough Community Enterprise has become recognised as a quality training and learning company, and with the help of this programme has expanded rapidly since its creation less than 10 years ago. This successful impact of the programme in Stirling is reflected across Scotland. The programme was initially established, as we've heard, to address youth unemployment. As we've heard, the programme has now created over 7,500 jobs in Scotland. This level of job creation in itself is very welcome, but the programme goes further. It also provides jobs for vulnerable and disadvantaged young people who often find themselves furthest away from the jobs market, and provides the opportunity for these young people to acquire skills and training that they can carry forward into the world of work. This is a unique part of the programme, I believe, its ability to reach young people furthest from the market, and I would like to highlight some specific examples of where the CGS helps young people who are furthest away from the market. For example, young people with disabilities or poor health, young people with convictions or care experience backgrounds, early service leavers from the armed forces, young people from ethnic minorities. In many cases, it gives young people a second chance. The CGS also serves to clearly illustrate that vulnerable young people can and do bring valuable skills to the workforce and the economy. They can become role models by showing that barriers can be overcome and that long-term and sustainable employment or other positive outcomes are successful. The ratio of total positive outcomes from the programme, including jobs, volunteering and going on to further education, is over 60%, which I think is a very positive outcome and a very positive performance. In addition to the positive outcomes on jobs and developing the employability of young people who might not otherwise achieve sustainable employment, the programme is further evidence of the efficacy of the prevention agenda as outlined by the Christie Commission, targeting those we know face barriers to a successful future. Ignoring these challenges is not an option and virtually guarantees that vulnerable and disadvantaged groups will face in the future poverty, inequality and poor health. By proactively helping people who face challenges into work and by furnishing them with the skills, confidence and experience, we can improve their life chances, reduce the need for costly state intervention later on, and crucially, they can be optimistic about their future. And I think this programme has demonstrated this very clearly. This programme is also unique in the sense that it offers only jobs within Scotland's dynamic third sector and roles which demonstrate a community benefit. This allows Scotland's charities to increase capacity and also help communities and unemployed and vulnerable young people. Deputy Presiding Officer, I once again thank Adam Tomkins for bringing this issue and debate to the Chamber, and I congratulate everyone involved in this successful programme. Thank you.
I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Presiding Officer, firstly, thanks to Adam Tomkins for leading this debate on community jobs, which we've heard is a programme designed and delivered by SCVO to help bring down youth unemployment aimed at people furthest from the labour market. Can I take this opportunity just to apologise to the Presiding Officer and to the Member that I'm unable to stay to hear the Minister's response due to another meeting, but I did want to make a contribution in what I think is a subject area which should preoccupy this Parliament. Speaking up for those who've had the most difficulties in life, who want to make it in the world of work to get a better life for themselves. I think it's why most of us came into politics. And so the programme we are discussing today is one of the best examples of a programme that has made a real difference. And it shows how important the third sector are, being critical partners for government in providing support for vulnerable people. And I think, as many members have said in the past, I think recognition is due to the work of the third sector in probably what is probably a very difficult time for people in work who need a step up. It seems to me that providing a real working environment with a competitive application system is essential in order to prepare people for the real world of work, and that includes applying for their jobs as well. We've heard many important stories. Adam Tomkins talks, and I've read about the story of Ryan, not had an easy life, that many people need a second chance in their life. They just need a step up because they have the motivation and they have the talent to get on, and that's all they simply need. But there are two groups in particular which have benefited from the programme, people with disability and those with care experience. 34% of care leavers were not in education or training when they were 19 years old. It's very worrying that they've already lost out when they've reached the age of 19. Naomi Eisenstadt said in her advice to the Scottish Government on tackling poverty that it was clear that the age group of 16 to 24 is a key time in a person's life that can determine so much of their future and that there should be a focus on it. Now, one of the key aspects of the community job programme is that it gives them experience, it gives them confidence, but importantly, it gives them a wage. Phase 6 of the programme is only open to vulnerable people with disabilities, young people with convictions, and homeless people. 1 million people in Scotland have a disability. That's 1 in 5. We're not going to improve these figures unless there is help such as this provided by community jobs. We know from previous debates that it should be a real focus for the government, as half of young disabled people of working age are out of work. Disabled people are more than twice as likely not to have qualifications. According to Inclusion Scotland, they also say that it's significantly more likely that they are significantly more likely to experience unfair treatment at work. So a scheme such as this that lets them gain experience in an environment that is set up to help them succeed will make a life-changing difference to many people with a disability. I'm delighted to support the debate today and delighted to support the work of SCVO in their community jobs programme. Thank you.
I call Tavish Scott to be followed by Claire Hawkey.
Hey, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, after the political knockabout of an hour ago, it's certainly I'm grateful to Mr. Tomkins for bringing some sane and a more dignified debate to the Chamber for this brief members' debate, which is useful because it gives many of us, Mr. Gibson illustrated this, the chance to say something positive about a community project or something that's happening in our respective areas. I too want to thank Adam Tomkins for doing that because he gives me the chance to talk about the Shetland Community Bike Project, which absolutely depends on Community Jobs Scotland for the subsidy that's available to help with the paid placements. And wouldn't exist were that scheme that Community Jobs Scotland run not to be there. And for that, I'd just like to say thank you to all those who've been through it, because the placements I have seen in that particular project, and I should say self-evidently that the bike project actually survives because it depends on all of us in Shetland who've outgrown our bikes or whose children have outgrown our bikes to make donations of the bikes to this project. They're then taken by the team who work there and I suppose, for want of a better word, regenerated into something that the retail trade will then accept again. And it's a classic bit of recycling, but it happens because of Community Jobs Scotland. And it helps people who do have mental health issues, who have possibly a criminal conviction, who are struggling with disabilities, who have no work experience, and who also are long-term unemployed. And as the brilliant Caroline Adamson, who runs it, told me the other day, the outcomes, I know we're beloved of the word outcomes in the world of Parliament these days, but I'd rather put it like this, that people are better for it because of that work. So they do come out of this programme substance-free, there's a reduced risk of reoffending, they stay off benefits and pay taxes, and they have improved confidence and self-esteem, which in my humble opinion might be actually one of the most profound improvements that can be made in people's lives where that is so necessary. So this is a programme that matters. It provides, in this particular incidence, a training fund of up to £200 per trainee, which allows the Shetland Bike Project to provide valuable training to the individual, and it gets people back into work, it gets people into areas that they want to be in, and it in that sense is a vital part of the infrastructure in Shetland to help those less fortunate than the rest of us. And that's why Community Jobs Scotland should be applauded for all the work they do in this area, as Adam Tomkins gave a much wider perspective than I'm going to for that, and indeed so as should the SCVO for their work in this area as well. It's schemes like the Shetland Community Bike Project that make me proud to be a constituency representative, because they make a difference to people that I can't dream of helping, and they do it in a very real way. Thank you.
Claire Hawkey, followed by Bill Bowman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also add my thanks to Adam Tomkins for bringing this motion to Parliament and this debate. And I'm glad that we're seeing a glimmer of cross-party agreement here, that the Scottish Government is right to proactively intervene to help marginalised and disadvantaged groups trying to enter the workplace. The Scottish Government recognises that some in our society have very specific needs, and that many people need support to help them transition out of unemployment. So the Scottish Council on Voluntary Services, working with the Scottish Government, have pioneered Community Jobs Scotland. And this programme, as we've heard, aims to help vulnerable young people into paid job training opportunities in the third sector. As a mental health nurse, I'm pleased to read stories like that from the East Newark Recovery Group in Fife. They provide support for people with mental health and or substance abuse issues, and have been involved in the Community Jobs Scotland project. And because of their Community Jobs Scotland employees, their drop-in centre has been able to open an extra 2 days a week, and they've been able to extend their free soup service over the week. Four more people each week have been able to benefit from outreach and housing support services than would otherwise have been possible because of Community Jobs Scotland. Fern, one of the CJS employees, now hopes to work in mental health, and I wish her all the very best in an extremely rewarding and worthwhile career. Presiding Officer, Fern's success is repeated across the programme, with the most recent figures available showing a positive outcome rate of 69%, with over half of people moving into employment. In South Lanarkshire, 370 jobs have been created in the CJS programmes, with a 55% rate of positive outcomes. And this shows us that if you invest in people and work with them to help them build a career, You can change lives. Now let's contrast this positive, progressive, compassionate and moreover highly successful project with the DWP's approach. The Director of Employment Services at SCVO in 2014 said that Community Jobs Scotland, and I quote, stands in stark contrast to the failing DWP work programme, which is only getting 18% of people into a job. And that she was appalled that the Westminster government extended the DWP's failing work programme. At the DWP, cases are handled not by a compassionate and committed body like the SCVO. They are instead handled by companies like Atos. Their aims are not to help people like Fern and the 370 people in South Lanarkshire get into the workplace and turn their lives around, but purely to process numbers on a screen. For the DWP, people are there to claim and be moved on. If they can be prevented from claiming, more the better. Now, I know the Conservatives don't like to talk about it, but the DWP have caused untold stress and worry to people the length and breadth of this country. It's been reported this week in Third Force News that questions such as, why have you not killed yourself yet, have routinely been asked of people who have mental health issues by staff working on behalf of the DWP. I would ask everyone here to reflect on the differences that that approach and the one Community Jobs Scotland takes. All people looking for work need support. And I'm so proud this government's work to help those most in need of help establish themselves in the job market with a CV and real job prospects. Just imagine what we could do if this government also had control over the DWP in Scotland. We could extend the successful solutions that even the Scottish Tories acknowledge to everyone who needs help finding a job. Presiding officer, I want to see a benefits system that looks after people when they need it, but also supports them get back on their feet when they're ready. In Scotland, we've proved that with the right support, most people can get back into work and build a career and their own self-confidence. I'm glad that the Scottish Tories have perhaps inadvertently recognised this, and perhaps they can tell their Westminster colleagues to devolve the DWP so we can help all of Scotland's unemployed people kickstart their careers.
I call Bill Bowman to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'll continue on the earlier consensual approach. I'm pleased to be able to participate in this afternoon's debate, and I want to thank my colleague Adam Tomkins for securing it. At the outset, I want to commend the Community Jobs Security Employability Programme and highlight their success in the North East, where there was a 61.6% positive outcome rate for those who took part. This is a particularly pertinent topic for debate this week, given that it is Scottish Apprenticeship Week, and I know that colleagues from across the Chamber either have already or will be visiting employers and speaking with staff and apprentices to hear more about the positive differences that such opportunities can make to our young people and their career paths. On Monday, I visited an employer in Dundee who has been taking on apprentices for the past 6 years, including some vulnerable young people. During that visit, we spoke about the importance of making sure that in such a competitive employment market as the one which exists today, our young people are as ready as they can be to enter the workforce. And initiatives like Community Jobs Scotland and the apprenticeship employers, such as the ones I've visited, have a role to play in assisting with that. For example, as part of their apprenticeship, the young people I spoke to were given advice on putting together a CV, filling out an application form, familiarised themselves with the various tests that are a common feature of the application process nowadays, and what I found particularly interesting, were involved in mock interviews so that they know how to present themselves and what to expect when they walk into a live job interview. Although the practical experience of working in a company will stand these young people in good stead, I believe these helpful skills will be even more important when it comes to looking for employment at the end of their apprenticeship. Deputy Presiding Officer, according to the February 2017 labour market statistics, Scotland's unemployment rate among 18 to 24-year-olds was 11.5%, which is 11.5% too many. While these figures represent a decrease when compared to the previous year's statistics, it is clear that more still needs to be done to engage with those young people in Scotland who are that bit harder to reach, as we heard earlier, but who would benefit enormously from such an opportunity as those offered by the Community Jobs Scotland Employability Programme. That is why I support the announcement last month that the funding has been made available for phase 6 of the programme, which, as stated in the motion, will support the creation of up to 700 job training opportunities, including opportunities specifically designed to support young people in our care system, those with criminal convictions, carers and military early service leavers. I'm also pleased that there will be 100 ring-fenced places for those who have a disability or long-term health condition. To conclude, every young person in our country deserves the chance to succeed and reach their full potential. Anything that we in this chamber can do together to support them and nurture their talent, we should. Thank you.
Daniel Johnson, followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And let me add my thanks to Adam Tomkins for bringing this debate forward, because I think it's really important that we celebrate this fantastic scheme that SCVO is responsible for. And I think it's a fantastic opportunity to really talk about what we need to do in terms of actually boosting employment and employability. But it's also a huge pleasure for me because I was the sponsor of the reception held by SCVO, where Ryan Brown received his award as the 7,500th CJS employee. And that was a huge pleasure for me. It was also a huge pleasure to be complimented on what I said that day. I was mainly complimented for speaking for less than a minute. And I know that members across the chamber would hope that I just take that hint. But the main reason that it was a good thing that I spoke for less than a minute that day was so that we could hear the story from Ryan. Because I think it's only by hearing these stories we really understand the true frustrations and difficulties that so many people have in terms of finding employment. And I think Ryan's story was no less the truth. Now, I don't want to embarrass him, and I can see him up in the gallery, and I think both colleagues across the chamber have already put the facts, but I think for me it was the emotions in that story. I think we could all feel the frustrations that he felt growing up in a loving family, but one blighted by addiction, both in drugs and alcohol, and the true tragedy. I mean, it was a sad story. I don't think there was a dry eye in the house when we heard about the deaths that Ryan encountered. And we could feel, because of that tragedy and those frustrations, why that cycle could so easily have just repeated, that it could have gone on. And we could see why it was such a huge benefit that Community Jobs Scotland existed, that was able to actually hold out that hand of help to Ryan. And then finally, the emotion of pride. And we could all see the pride that Ryan had because he secured his first tenancy. It was in a stable relationship. And I think for me, it was the pride that you could see he felt for being the role model to his younger brother. Because I think that's what we all need, is those role models, to see how to take those opportunities in life. Because if you don't have those role models, you don't have that assistance, how can we expect things to be different? And that's why this scheme is so important, because the barriers to employment is not simply about just having the ability to take a job. People need that help. They need that act of assistance, and that's what this scheme does. It's about supporting work, reaching out to those who are far from the job market. Because I think for me, ultimately, that is work is the most important and precious thing that we can ensure that people have in society, because it's work that provides opportunity. It's work that breaks poverty. It's work that breaks that cycle of despair that blights so many of our communities. And I think Dean Lockhart did an excellent job earlier on about explaining so many of those things and the different groups that can get help through schemes such as this. So I think it's fantastic that we're here to celebrate Community Jobs Scotland. I think, apart from anything else, because it represents a truly successful partnership between government and the third sector. And again, I don't want to, you know, any members on the SNB benches to fall off their chairs, but I think this is an example of something where we should celebrate what the Scottish Government has done. Because I think it's partnerships such as this which actually really can make a difference. So I would like to congratulate the Scottish Government for investing the £50 million in Community Jobs Scotland, because it is exactly the sort of thing that we need to do to break the cycle of poverty and frankly, frustration that occurs in too many communities. And I think it's exactly these sorts of things in Apprentice Week that we should be looking at. Looking at ways that we can partner with the third sector, form these partnerships between government and third sector organisations to look at how you can boost opportunity, increase employment, and ultimately improve the opportunity for everyone in our communities. Thank you.
The last of the open speakers is Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome this member's debate put forward by my friend and colleague Adam Tomkins on the important topic of Community Jobs Scotland. I also welcome everyone involved who join us today. As the motion rightly points out, Community Jobs Scotland is not a training programme, but provides a paid job for young people in the third sector with targeted efforts to help hard-to-reach and vulnerable young people into employment. And this is an important distinction to make, for it offers paid work for those who want to get up and go, get involved, get to work and contribute. Community Jobs Scotland provides that opportunity to those who may well struggle to find it otherwise. But this isn't a handout. There is a competitive application process and an interview before any offer is made. This places much value on the job, a sense of ownership of the role and pride. It also gives a taste of the real work environment and provides valuable experience of the recruitment process. As an employer myself, I understand the significance of this. The programme has been a success, and since 2011, it has created paid jobs for just over 7,000 young people and a total of 68% of positive outcomes into jobs in volunteering or education. But however, an average of just 52% being retained by their employer after their job has ended, which I would actually like to see improved. The motion highlights the successes from Glasgow. The latest we've heard today is Ryan Brown, who will soon take on the role of Trainee Development Worker with Move On. The stories of seven young men, Dominic Gibbons, Callum McLeod, Lee Maharan, Callum Borland, Kevin O'Donnell, Barry O'Donnell, Gordon McCabe, have turned their lives around with help from Community Jobs Scotland, helping to repair and maintain housing stock in the Govan Housing Association, as Adam Tomkins pointed out earlier. All I would say is, where are the girls? In the South of Scotland region, there have been over 1,000 jobs created and 64,000 positive outcomes. The jobs range from admin assistant to assistant hockey development coach, from multimedia and publicity assistant to interior design assistant, which actually sounds quite appealing. There are many different jobs out there which can provide the level of experience to go on and be successful in the respective field that you want to get into. For example, if an applicant had an interest in bikes, a related role can be found. Community Jobs Scotland caters for all and is open to all. It doesn't force anyone in a particular direction, but instead helps those enter their preferred profession. The good work continues. Stage 6, now underway, will help create a further 700 job opportunities for vulnerable young unemployed people aged 16 to 29 through a range of third sector organisations across all of our 32 local authorities. I would briefly like to touch on some of those organisations that participate in my region. We have Apex Borders. Its aim is to reduce reoffending, tackle deprivation and make communities safer. Those who have been involved with Apex have said, and I quote, "My confidence in myself and other people has increased. By attending this course, I now feel more confident in getting out of the house, travelling on public transport, and doing something for me." Another said, "Apex has given me the tools, support, and confidence in order to get me where I want to be in life." These statements are testaments to the great work that Apex Borders does and the positive impact that it has. The Dunbar Community Kitchen, situated within Community Centre, where I hold my surgeries, make the best use of local produce. The cafe has strong links with the local fishmonger, butcher and greengrocer, and they will happily use up any garden surplus from local allotments. But most importantly, they give opportunities to those who want a career in hospitality and catering, and I can unreservedly recommend the homemade scones. Deputy Presiding Officer, People's Can is also another example in the Borders, working towards building community resilience and sustainability. To conclude, ultimately, all these organisations do a great role giving opportunities to those who want to go and get them. With a hard work ethic and can-do attitude, I pay tribute to all those involved and those in the gallery attending today, and I wish you the best of luck in the future.
I now call Jamie Hepburn to close this debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I join with others and begin by thanking Adam Tomkins for bringing forward the motion for debate today, as he, Bill Bowman and Daniel Johnson, possibly others as well, mentioned this week is Scottish Apprenticeship Week, so it is a timely juncture in which to have this debate, although we, of course, debated Apprenticeship Week last week when Fulton McGregor brought forward a members' debate then as well. I know that many members, we've heard from a number already, have been undertaking a range of visits associated with Apprenticeship Week. I myself, as you might expect, given my ministerial role, Presiding Officer, having to undertake a range of visits as well, and thoroughly enjoying the opportunity to do so. And the reason that I think it ties to this programme in particular is I, and I'm sure others, have been able to encounter and meet a number of modern apprentices who began their journey towards undertaking apprenticeship by engaging in exactly the type of programme, not necessarily just, but exactly the same type of programme as Communities Jobs Scotland, that's allowed them to begin their employability journey progressing towards an apprenticeship, which is an important reminder, I think, that this programme is part of a family of employability and training initiatives that we are able to offer. And not only should we be out visiting and seeing opportunities for apprentices as we do in this Apprenticeship Week, but a number of members, I think all members, as happens in members' debates, is rightly the case, have highlighted activities associated with Community Jobs Scotland taking place in their own area. I've got an example in my own constituency of the Scottish Wildlife Trust taking part in Communities Jobs Scotland in Cumbernauld. And I would encourage all members taking part in this debate, or indeed those who are not here, if they've not yet availed themselves the opportunity, to go along and see some of the Community Jobs Scotland activity taking place in their constituencies. Can I also join with others in welcoming those Community Jobs Scotland employers and employees who have come along to listen to the members' debate today. I'll be very happy to join with them in the garden lobby afterwards. As members will, I'm sure, be aware, the Scottish Government holds great value in our Community Jobs Scotland offering that we provide funding to the SCVO to deliver. And the First Minister, of course, announced at the recent gathering event in Glasgow that we will continue our commitment to Community Jobs Scotland with a further £6.1 million of funding for the coming financial year, which will be phase 7 of the programme, maintaining the £6.1 million funding that we provided this financial year for phase 6. I also had the pleasure of attending the gathering event where I outlined some of the detail of the programme for next year. I won't reiterate that because I think it's already been highlighted, but the theme of the gathering yesterday was celebrating the success of Community Jobs Scotland, and I was very delighted to be able to have the opportunity to highlight from my perspective some of the successes of the programme. And since taking up my post as Minister for Employability and Training, I've been very hugely impressed, overwhelmingly impressed, by the dedication and commitment of the third sector to ensuring that young people are afforded the opportunity to achieve success through programmes such as Community Jobs Scotland. It is, of course, one of the most valuable and successful youth employability interventions we have. It of course gives young people the chance to learn and experience the world of work, to acquire the skills, training and industry recognised accreditation that they can acquire through participating in the programme, which is of course an important foundation that young people can build on as they continue through their career path. But I think it was a very important point made by Adam Tomkins, Pauline McNeill and Rachel Hamilton. And it is important, I think, we should recognise that these opportunities come around through a competitive interview process. Now, not all of our programmes are based on that methodology, but this one is. And I think that is an important element because, of course, that reflects the reality for most in the labour market. So not only will young people participating in the programme acquire the skill set through the actual experience of getting into the programme, but also by going through that interview process, they're gaining a valuable experience as well. Daniel Johnson was absolutely right, though. Not only did attending the gathering allow me to set on the record what I view the success as, Daniel Johnson was absolutely right to say that the best people to hear from are those who have participated themselves. Ryan Brown, who's been mentioned, was at the gathering, was very happy to be able to speak with him. Govan Housing Association, which was mentioned by Adam Tomkins, were there, and that was a really good opportunity to hear not only the benefits of the programme to the young people to take part in themselves, but the benefits to an employer. They were effusive with praise for the programme. I also heard from Andrew Marshall, who works for Leap Sports Scotland, who I believe are here today. Andrew may himself be here today, and he was able to talk about having gone through the experience of going through university, graduating, then finding it hard to access employment for a variety of reasons, and being able to get into work through taking part in the Community Jobs Scotland programme. I have to say, with due respect to those individuals, they were very compelling speakers all, but I was really taken with the experience of Jamie Round, who works with Nielsen Community Development Trust as a cycle mechanic and chief of facilities, delivering workshops in schools and in the community. And Jamie was a young man who had a difficult start to life as well, and actually ended up being detained in custody at Lomas Prison. And he spoke very compellingly, not only of the great benefits to his ability to access the labour market, but actually to turn his entire life around through interacting with this programme. It was a very salient reminder of the importance for this type of programme, not only in providing young people with the opportunity to get into the labour market, but to be able to get their entire life on track. So that is why this programme is so important, because not only is it about that critical element of providing training, getting people into work, but it is that chance to turn lives around. We do see, to take the term that Tavis Scott seems to like, we do achieve very positive outcomes through the initiative, but more fundamentally than that, and of course we want to achieve positive outcomes, but more fundamentally than that, we achieve great things for individual human beings through this programme. So that's why I'm very proud that we support it as administration, and I look forward to phase seven this coming financial year continues to achieve great success.
This meeting is suspended until 2:30 p.m.